Inside of these boxes right here are all of the parts that I need to make one of the most unique gaming PCs you've ever seen. Looking for a new PC this holiday season? Head on over to the NZXT Build Black Friday sale and put together the system of your dreams. Choose the games you want to play, set a budget, and NZXT Build will handle the rest. Choose from a number of different pre-built systems, like the NZXT Streaming PC, featuring an AMD Ryzen 7 3700X and RTX 3070 graphics card. All PCs are also sold with a 2-year all-in-one warranty. And if you order between 6 p.m. Pacific this Thanksgiving Day through midnight on Friday, you'll get 10% off any order of a custom or pre-built gaming PC, including any accessories or peripherals. To check out NZXT Build for yourself, click the link down in the video description. Welcome back to Craft Computing, everyone. As always, I'm Jeff. Like you probably read in the title, this gaming PC is going to be unlike any that you've ever seen, as it has a CPU and GPU on board that really never saw a consumer release. More specifically, this is a motherboard that is utilizing the AMD A9-9820 APU. Now, if you recognize that part number, that's because that's the exact same APU used in the Xbox One S. So it's going to be packing a decent amount of power, but probably the even better aspect of this was the price, as the motherboard and APU combo only cost me $125 from AliExpress after shipping, and it even included a CPU cooler, which I was not expecting. Dig out the motherboard here. There we go. I didn't stack that with a lot of thought behind it. So let's get right to the main event here, shall we? Now, like I said, this is kind of a unique package, as number one, AMD never actually released the A9-9820 for consumers. And number two, while this is a micro ATX motherboard, you'll notice there's no CPU socket on here, at least not in the traditional sense. That's because the A9-9820 is a BGA CPU, meaning it is soldered directly to the motherboard. Inside the box is your standard fare for a knockoff Chinese motherboard, that is an IO shield and one SATA cable. I don't know how many times I've said that on this channel. However, like I've mentioned, there's also an included CPU cooler. Now, the cool thing about this board is it uses a standard Intel 1150 pattern for the mounting hardware, which means that we could either use this one, which is a actually fairly beefy aluminum heatsink, or any standard Intel mounting platform. So any third-party cooler will likely fit right onto this board. Now, earlier this month, Lexar asked me if I had any cool projects coming up that I could feature the NM610 PCI Express NVMe drive in, and I think what I'm going to do to this system definitely qualifies as unique. So this is a 1TB Gen 3x4 NVMe drive, and it is going to be the main storage inside of this PC. There is an NVMe slot on this board, which I am going to take advantage of and get 1TB of storage to hold my OS and all of my games. And the feature set on this motherboard doesn't end there, as the A9-9820 is only a dual channel memory capable CPU. However, there are 4 DDR3 DIMM slots on this board, so I figured why not fill them up. I've got 4 Kingston DDR3 1600 MHz sticks that is going to help power this system. Moving on to the power supply, and we are also going fairly unique in that regard, as this is going to be inside of a fairly small form factor case, so I needed a fairly small form factor power supply. So enter this, a 250 watt Pico ITX power supply. This has pretty much everything you could ever wish for in a small form factor power supply. It has a 12 volt barrel jack input, as well as one SATA connector, one Molex connector, and one 8-pin EPS connector to go with the 24-pin DC to DC converter. Now, because this takes a 12 volt input and outputs 250 watts, you actually need a fairly beefy power brick to supply it, which is why I have this fairly beefy power brick. This is a 12 volt 20 amp power supply. This is capable of delivering about 260 watts. Now, I'm hoping not to run this external to the PC. Rather, I want to find a way to mount it inside the PC so as to have the least amount of clutter outside. Now, why do I say least amount of clutter? Well, it's because of the case that I'm going to be putting this system into. You see, as this is the APU and brains out of an Xbox One S, I decided the best case to install it into would be an Xbox One S. Now, unfortunately, I'm not going to get to the case modding portion of this build today. That's going to happen in a later video, so make sure you're subscribed so you don't miss that one. Today is going to be about testing this A9-9820 APU, but This system is probably only capable of 720p 60 frames per second in most modern games. It is not the most powerful system in the world. So why am I even bothering with this? You see, just about 2 weeks ago here on Talking Heads, your once weekly live show for the latest in beer and tech news every Wednesday night at 8 p.m. Pacific time right here on YouTube, you should totally check us out, we talked about the imminent release of the GPD Win 3, the latest generation small form factor handheld gaming PC. And I mentioned on that show, I've always wanted one of those devices, just to have for portable gaming use. Little did I know that brand new friend of the show, Andrew, would reach out and offer to donate his Win GPD Generation 1. So thank you, Andrew. I have been having an absolute blast with this machine. I've been playing games natively on it, as well as remoting into one of my gaming PCs to stream them into my bedroom while I'm playing on a 5-inch screen. However, I hate changing the settings on my gaming PC just to play on this, such as resolution inside of games and whatnot. I would much rather have a dedicated PC just for streaming games over to this. And that's where this comes in. You see, the GPD Win 1 has a 1280 by 720 screen, which means I only need to game at 720p, 60 frames per second, which is pretty much exactly what this should be capable of. So this is essentially going to become a dedicated game streaming machine specifically for my GPD Win handheld. However, this will also take care of console emulation here in my office. I'm probably gonna hook this up to the TV, and if I wanna sit on my couch right here and play games, this will be the machine that I use. Now I have pretty much everything in this build already planned out, except for which CPU cooler that I want to use. Now while I'm sure this is more than capable of cooling this chip, it's also about twice as tall as I need it to be to fit inside of the Xbox One S shell. So I'll likely be picking up a low profile cooler of some kind here next week when I plan on doing this build. But for right now, let's go ahead and get this system put together, plugged in, and what do you say we get to some game testing? So, how was your day? Those among you with good eyes might have noticed that the A9-9820 is not up and running. In fact, I felt this was the most appropriate place to put it in my office, because I'm never going to use it again, but I like it in that it's a very unique platform. So, where do I start on this one? There are definitely some very unique problems which I've never faced before with this motherboard. For starters, this is not the first board that you saw me put together. That one's sitting right here. And it's a really good thing I bought two of them because this one is DOA. So as you can see, my frustration started very early on in this process. So I took everything off the bad motherboard, put them on the good motherboard, and fired this one up. And it still wouldn't post, at least not with the NVMe drive installed. You see, the BIOS on this board defaults to having the storage boot up in the UEFI mode, and unfortunately, this BIOS also prevents your NVMe drive from starting up in UEFI mode. You have to set your storage over to legacy mode. But the fun with this BIOS did not end there. I run a Pixie boot server for installing Windows on a lot of my test machines around here, and this refused to Pixie boot in legacy mode. You had to boot in UEFI mode. Now luckily, once this board is powered on, it really doesn't matter how you booted up the various parts of the board, whether it be in legacy mode or UEFI. You can still boot a UEFI operating system off of the NVMe drive. You just have to select legacy mode to actually make the board post. Another oddity about this board, it's about 50-50 on whether or not it will actually boot up once you hit the power button. Sometimes it'll post within about 2 or 3 seconds and you're off to the races. Other times it takes 10, 15, even 20 seconds after hitting the power button to reach your BIOS splash screen. There's also an equal chance that the board will not post at all. The fan will ramp up to 100% and stay there, and you're left staring at nothing but a black screen. So after fighting about 2 hours worth of BIOS and boot up gremlins, I finally got Windows installed on this and booted up. And we can finally take a look at the hardware that's inside of here. The CPU inside of this thing is recognized as an RX 8120, likely a direct cross model with the FX 8120 from AMD. Like its FX counterpart, this is also an 8-core, 8-threaded CPU, although we later reclassified that as 4-core, 8-threaded because of the architecture of the excavator chips, but that's another story. Where it differs from the FX 8120 is in the clock speed. This one has a 1.7 GHz base clock with a 2.35 GHz all-core turbo, whereas the FX8120 has a base clock of 3.1 GHz and an all-core turbo of 4.0. So as much maligned as the FX processors were, yeah, you can pretty much cut their middle ground CPU in half as far as performance goes. So how much cut down is the CPU's performance? Well, I decided to run this through Cinebench R15, because I'm an idiot. In multi-threaded workloads, the RX 8120 scored a 282. Now, 282 doesn't sound too horrible. However, take it in the context of this. The AMD FX4100, which we now understand to be a two-core four-threaded CPU, scored a 261. And an Intel i5-2400 Sandy Bridge chip with four cores and four threads scored a 433. Not looking so great so far. But the fun is just beginning. You see, I also ran this through Cinebench R15 in single-threaded mode, because apparently I'm really an idiot. To start with, I'll give you the time that I stared at the screen waiting for the CPU to finish this test. It took 17 minutes and 49 seconds to run through Cinebench single-threaded. I've never even known a CPU that takes more than 5 minutes to complete the single-threaded test, and that still feels like an eternity. And to put this in perspective, a while ago I benchmarked an i5-3317U, which is a low-volt i5 mobile CPU, and it had a single-threaded score of 91. I also happen to have my FX4100 score, which was an 80 in single-threaded performance. Then there's probably the most hated chip that I've ever reviewed on this channel, the AMD Opteron 6386SE, and it came in with a 77. So, how bad are we talking? 37. 37. We are less than half as fast as the Opteron 6386. We're less than half as fast as an FX4100. Heck, that i5-2400 I mentioned in multi-threaded performance scored a 128. We are four times slower than an inexpensive Sandy Bridge i5. So let's just say I was thoroughly disappointed with CPU performance, but maybe the GPU on this can make me feel a little bit happier. So again, this is an APU system with the CPU and GPU on a single package, and it was advertised as having an R7-350 graphics card, which should get middling performance and, like I said, be able to play most games at 720p 60 frames per second. So what did we get? Well, to start with, a whole new set of problems. As I mentioned earlier, AMD never actually released this chip to consumers, so any search for an A9-9920 just shows up the AliExpress listing that I bought it from. Likewise, while this is kind of an R7-350, the R7-350 drivers from AMD's website will not install on this board. After a fair bit of searching on a number of internet forums, I don't even remember which one I stumbled across, someone finally had a working download link for the drivers for the CPU package. Once I had the drivers installed, I could finally take a peek at the GPU. And yet again, I was thoroughly disappointed. You see, the R7-350 has 12 compute units and 768 graphics cores, whereas this version is recognized as an RX-350 and only has 8 compute units with 512 graphics cores. So there's the GPU that I was promised, and then there's what was delivered, which is about 50% less. Ready for even more bad news? The BIOS that shipped with this motherboard essentially locks this APU to 512 megabytes of shared memory for the graphics card. That is laughable in this day and age. So with that knowledge in hand, I decided to try and run my gaming tests anyway. I ran 3DMark Firestrike, and it refused to load. I tried TimeSpy, it refused to load. I did manage to get the Skydiver integrated graphics test running and ended up scoring an 8800, but the demo wouldn't run. It ran through all the tests just fine, but for some reason it would try to launch the demo and then fail. I did manage to get Far Cry 2 running at 1080p 60 frames per second with medium settings. However, I'm not too impressed by that, as that is a 12-year-old game at this point, and I'm looking for something a little bit more modern. Now, to get my approval and stay running as a streaming PC, this would have to run games like Red Dead Redemption 2 and Doom Eternal at 720p 60 frames per second. However, there's a major problem with the RX350 graphics driver that's inside of here. It doesn't support Vulkan. Not only that, but I was kind of screwed by the 512 megabyte frame buffer anyway. But what if there was something I could do about that? While I was scrubbing the internet looking for answers and trying to find anyone with firsthand experience with this motherboard, I came across the YouTube channel Socket Sanctuary, which, by the way, I will have linked down in the video description. Go give him a look. He has two videos on this motherboard, and in his second video, he was able to get 2 gigabytes of video memory shared with the CPU. But how did he do it? Well, on the board that he received, it was a BIOS option where you could select anywhere from 256 megabytes to 2 gigabytes of shared video memory. In my BIOS, that wasn't an option that was available. Luckily, I already had my hands on some AMI BIOS editors and flash tools for these Chinese motherboards. So I was able to download the BIOS, modify the lines necessary to get that menu option to show up, and then reflash the motherboard. And eureka! I now have that menu option showing up and 2 gigabytes of memory shared with the CPU. But did that improve the performance at all? I was able to get 3D Mark TimeSpy to fully run, and that was abysmal at best, averaging about 4 frames per second through the entire test, and a final score of 2540. I managed to get BeamNG Drive up and running on this system as well. However, it averaged about 8 frames per second and was basically a slideshow the entire time. And I know there's one question you're all asking, but can it run Crysis? To my surprise, actually, yes, and fairly well. It ran at 1080p and averaged 60 frames per second with medium settings, so I'd say mission accomplished on that one. However, there's one glaring issue with all of these applications that I hadn't mentioned, and it comes back to the graphics drivers. You see, these drivers are very much beta, and they're also very old. I think the latest revision is about 2018, and there's a problem with these drivers. Anytime an application goes full screen, your mouse is no longer visible. Now, that might not sound like a huge deal, except when you're trying to navigate menus in a game, change settings, and start the game, it's really difficult to do so. Crysis also had some fairly weird graphical issues. While it had a great frame rate, it would have a red halo around every non-environmental object. There was also an issue of the in-game menus not showing up, so you couldn't modify your gun or change the mode your suit was in. It was all just completely invisible. You were also missing the heads-up display in general, so you had no idea what weapon you had selected, what your ammo count was, or how much health you had left. And the final nail in this motherboard's coffin is the remote gaming support. So I tried installing Parsec on this board, and as soon as I fired it up, it refused to load the host encoder, because this host has no encoder. That's right, the FX350 doesn't have a video encoder on board. So running Parsec is pretty much a no-go. So what's up for this project now? Well, I am still gonna build a PC into the Xbox One S, as I still do want a streaming PC for my GPD win, and the parts are already on the way, so make sure you're subscribed so you don't miss that build. But as far as these motherboards right here, what am I gonna do with those now? Well, this motherboard here, probably exactly what you see. It's gonna sit on a shelf and be an interesting conversation item, but nothing more. I considered giving it to my youngest daughter to play Minecraft on, but this doesn't even play Minecraft past 20 FPS. I have Intel integrated graphics that'll do better than that. So my GPD win is gonna have to wait a couple of more weeks before it gets a dedicated streaming box. But in the meantime, make sure to like this video if you liked it and subscribe to Craft Computing if you haven't done so already. Follow me on Twitter at Craft Computing to keep up with my daily shenanigans like this. And if you like the content you see on this channel and wanna help support me in what I do, consider joining the Patreon or Floatplane. Links are down in the video description. You'll get exclusive access to my Discord server where you can chat with myself and the other hosts from Talking Heads throughout the week. If you are in the US, I hope you have a fantastic Thanksgiving, and to all of you, I say thank you so much for watching this one, and as always, I will see you in the next video. Cheers, guys.